being recorded.
Hello.
Hey, so tonight we have a very special interview. Now this is the first time that I've ever done this before, and Rachel, you go through voice to skull, which most of the people getting gang stalked are now experiencing as well, and it's tormented some people so bad that they've actually gone out and killed people, killed themselves. They've gone into psychotic shock. A lot of people are getting drunk and high just to numb it out. The reason why I'm so interested in Voice of Skull is because I saw a clip from the Jesse Ventura show where Jesse Ventura, a former statesman, a former governor, also Navy SEAL, and wrestler, he was interviewing a CIA mind control expert, and the CIA mind control expert said that this technology was real. This he says on national television that they were not just messing with people. These voice to skull weapons were actually torturing people. And this takes me back to the old MK Ultra experiments of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And this stuff is happening and you're going through it. And tonight you've decided to come on and tell your experience, which is very courageous of you. I have to commend you on that. And you're going to tell people a little bit about how it feels, and you're going to talk about right now what their voices are telling you. Am I correct?
Yeah, correct. Right now they're telling me we're not going to tell you anything that's going to be of any value. That's what they just said.
Oh wow. So it's like they know everything you're about to do. They're watching you. Do they know what you're thinking?
Yes, they do. 'Cause I do think they have like some sort of two-way communication, like telepathy, because they do know what I'm thinking. Like if I have a thought, they do respond to it. So they respond to my thoughts, my actions, my decisions, my body language. They respond to everything. Sometimes they try to predict what I'm gonna do, what I'm gonna say. Because I remember the very, very first thing that they shouted at me was I had this really, really annoying guy that like was obsessed with me. And every time I'd look at the phone, I would think in my head, not this motherfucker again, right? And the very, very first thing I heard them say was he was calling me. I looked at my phone and all of them came out at once saying, not this motherfucker again. And that's when I like started shaking and dropped the phone, like, where are these people? And yeah, they're nowhere around. They're in my head.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So can you ask them questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they just said,
Maybe
we're
you
not going to tell you anything, they said. But they'll speak. They don't shut up. And right now they're saying, oh, yeah, you think you know us? We know you better than you know yourself.
Have they ever sworn at you?
Oh, yeah, they call me, they torment me. Like, they call me a nasty bitch all the time. They call me, like, a dope fiend. They call me a terrible mom. Like, they rank me every day on a scale from 1 to 10 of how shitty of a mom I am. What number am I today, guys? They say I'm a 3 today.
On a scale from 1 to 10 of being a good mother.
Yeah, so 10's a great mom, 1's the shittiest mom possible, and a 3 today, they say.
Right. Now let me ask you this. Is it the same? How many voices do you speculate or do you know that it is? Can you count them from time to time?
Yeah, so collectively, there's probably about 15, because they tend to impersonate my family and my friends. Stuff like that. But I did notice, like, I hadn't seen one of my friends in about 4 years. And after I went to visit her the other day, her voice has been in my head for a little bit after that. So they do kind of switch it up sometimes. But, like, right now, I just hear a group of people. And it sounds like the people that were in the institution with me. Because I recognize like the resident manager's voice. That's who's primarily talking to me right now, with kind of like a group of people behind her.
Right. Okay. So you know if the voices. So you think there may be a point to. Now, hold on, let me ask you something. Is it the same voices 24/7?
No. Here's an example. Like right now, I'm sitting in the bathroom in my house trying to see some solitude in here so that I can hear them a little better. And sometimes we'll impersonate the people, like, okay, so there's two adults home, you know, my roommates and my kids. And so every now and then they'll say something like my roommate saying something through the wall, or, you know, my fiance saying something through the wall at me. Like, when I was sitting in here, like, they mimic those two having a horrible conversation about how shitty of a person I am. So they mimic people talking shit about you, like, or they'll, like,
You're breaking up a little bit, Rachel.
Oh, it's like he'll be like, "Mommy, can I have some Tylenol?" And I'll go out there, and he didn't say that.
Oh, so they can mimic anybody's voice.
Anybody's. Like, sometimes they don't nail it perfectly, but yeah, they can. Like, I've heard your voice sometimes. Like, when I get off the phone with you, they'll be like, "Jamal says." And then your voice will come on, and you'll be like, "I'm secretly going to kill you when you come out to visit." You know what I mean? Like, so I do hear your voice sometimes, too, after I get off the phone with you for a little bit.
Yeah, I've heard this before. Now, I had a friend. He was the first person who contacted me back in June of 2016. I did my courses on B gang stalking. And he told me that he was hearing voices 24/7, and the voices were telling him that I was a part of it, and the voices were telling him all this stuff negative about me to him. And the first time I heard him say that, like, I didn't know what to think. Like, I knew that he was being gang stalked on a street level. And then the more he told me about the voices, this was all foreign to me. I didn't know what it was. The more he told me about it, I knew he was telling the truth. And then as his story progressed, more people emailed me, and eventually I ended up talking to them, and they were saying the exact same stuff. And I'm like, these people cannot be making this up. They're all saying the exact same thing. Like, it's the same scenarios that the way they're hearing the voices and what's happening. Like, they can't all be making this up. Like, this is real, right? And all these people were getting gang stalked on a street level, frightening, color stalking, you know, gaslighting with the lights on, all their neighbors putting the lights on in broad daylight outside their houses, you know, noise campaigns, you know, the covert drugging, the regular electronic weapons. Everybody was experiencing these, but then they kept talking about the voices. And so I realized that this isn't a joke. This isn't fake. It's not, these people aren't crazy. They're not, you know, they're not hallucinating. Like, there is something going on, and technology is being used to do it. And so right now, I just want to ask you, you know, you can distinguish, though, can you distinguish them manipulating the voice or between the other person, or does it sound like what you said with your son, it's pretty distinct. Like, sometimes you can't distinguish the voice at times, right?
Yeah, I've gotten better at distinguishing them over time. But at first, I was so confused. I couldn't tell the difference.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I can imagine. Now, I read a book about called Human Consciousness or something like that. It's written by Jim Keith, a wonderful author and a wonderful author and speaker from the 90s who did a lot of alternative research subjects. And his book went back to like the early 1900s, and it detailed this technology, the voice of skull technology. And for those who don't know, like, there's been mainstream newspaper articles, you know, with psychologists speaking about this going back to 1974, you know, and, you know, the Soviets were using psychotronic weapons, making people hear voices during the 60s in the Vietnam War. I mean, going back to Dr. Jose Delgado, back in the early 1950s, Dr. Delgado was putting electrodes in the heads of monkeys, and he was actually controlling matador bulls, their movements and whatnot. So, you know, if a mind control doctor can control the movements of a bull and control monkeys' minds and stuff, I'm pretty damn sure, you know, people can make people hear voices, you know? And so, I mean, in fact, I know it's true. You know, I'm not sure I know. But so there is historical connotation on this stuff. It has been going on, and there's survivors who've gone through this, who've there's actual people who've been financed and paid from the CIA from the lawsuits. Do you know anything about, have you heard about that?
No, that's new to me.
Yeah, there's actually people who've actually sued the CIA from the old, when the CIA, back in the Committee on Select Intelligence did an investigation into MK Ultra, and Richard Helms destroyed a lot of documents, but some of them still survived. And there was a congressional hearing, and the CIA admitted to using these sorts of technologies and doing this sorts of stuff. And there's people who were actually compensated for these similar sorts of mind control experiments. And you know, a lot of people have done no research on the subject, so when they hear your story, they might think you're hallucinating or you're crazy or you're on drugs, but what you're saying is absolutely happening and it's real. Like, they're probably even saying something to you right now.
Yeah, they're saying that they know exactly what I'm gonna say, and they nailed it. And what I was gonna say is, just common sense wise, of thousands and thousands of TIs out there can't be all having the same delusion, you know? So it's just common sense that it's really happening if, like, you know, groups and groups of people are getting together and saying, this is happening to me too. Like, we're not all delusional if we're all having the same delusions, you know what I mean?
Right. Well, you know, that's just like people in China have an Eastern philosophy, an Eastern way of life. Their whole world is completely different from our world. They come from a completely different, just everything's different. Then in America, we're coming off a Western philosophy, a Western way of life. Why would people on two different sides of the world, under two different philosophical backgrounds, two different cultural backgrounds, different meanings for the way they interpret things are just far different than us. Why would we be seeing the same specific things if it was all, if it was a delusional paranoia, it'd be far different. Why would we have an exact definition of the delusional paranoia? Like, what, you know what I mean? You would think it would vary, wouldn't
Yeah, and the voices
you?
are saying now that, oh, we just dosed everyone with LSD on the planet at the same time. They're not being helpful right now.
Man, that is cool. That is really cool. I wish science, you know, I wish science had a way to where, I'm sure they do. I'm sure somebody out there is. If they don't have it, I'm sure they're working on it. But a way to where we could record these transmissions. Have you not?
Oh,
You're
I know.
familiar? Yeah, wouldn't that be the bomb? Now, you've heard of remote neuromonitoring, right?
Yeah.
You think now? What? Where? This is what we're. This is what. This is. Rachel, what we're working on currently, right, is coming up with more information and presentations to people about remote neuromonitoring versus what voice to skull is. Making voice to skull is directed energy weapons that's actually making people hear acoustic sounds, noises, and whatnot. Then there's remote neuromonitoring, which is a whole different thing. And it sounds like they're probably using both of them on you.
That's what I'm thinking, yeah. 'Cause I didn't know there
Yeah.
was a difference.
Yeah. I mean, the only I was familiar with remote neuromonitoring to some degree, and I knew there was people literally hearing things and feeling certain ways. Remote neuromonitoring works more on the mood, changes in mood, but there are people hearing things and feeling different things and perceiving the reality in certain ways, and their minds are being messed with. In that sense, the, you know, remote neuromonitoring, and then there's the voice of skull directed energy weapons, where people are just straight up hearing stuff that is re they're really hearing it, but to the outside world they're not hearing it, you know. And so it's almost like you're like a living example of this. Like, you know, it's like, who do you think these people are that are messing with you like this? Who are they?
I've been trying to figure that out. I mean, the voices themselves have told me so many things. They've told me that they're the government. They've told me it's just the people at the institution I went to. They say it's a, oh, at the very, very beginning, they told me it was my family and friends just stepping in to mess with me. My dad would like be like making fun of me for like a half hour, and then he'd pass the mic to my stepmom, you know? They've told me so many scenarios, and I'm pretty sure none of them are true. I'm still trying to figure out who these people are and why they're wasting so much time and energy doing this to me.
Right,
And
right.
they're saying right now you don't know the can of worms that you opened by going on air with this. You think your phone's hacked now? Just wait till you have no phone again. So they make threats too.
So you get threat, they're threatening you?
Yeah, they're saying that that because I'm going on air about what they're saying, that they're gonna hack my phone to the point where I'm not gonna have a phone anymore. Because they've done that before. Like, my phone straight up just got a virus and, like, kaput. Like, I think this is, like, my 10th phone.
Now, this is, like, some Star Trek stuff because, now, I've heard of people that have worked respectable jobs who've worked, you know, really good jobs, and they've heard voices. Like, there's been, I remember hearing about there was a man on Wall Street who said he was hearing voices and stuff, and I remember this was like a few years ago. He said he was hearing voices and whatnot, and it came out. And, you know, people have had all sorts of crazy things happen to them like this. And even speaking of Wall Street, I want to take it a step further. You know, I've heard stories on Wall Street about people, like, losing one deal and jumping out the window and killing themselves over one business deal. They lose a couple $1 million on a bad exchange, and they just kill themselves, you know? And you know,
I have something to add to that, because they do mess with employment really, really bad. Because I remember, like, after I got gang stalked out of my last job, I had a job interview, and when I talked to the manager at this pancake house, because I was applying for a line cook position there, I didn't have a pen or a paper with me, but he's like, yeah, come back for a second interview on Monday. And the voices kept telling me over and over and over again, because, like, my dad or, you know, my significant other at the time, he'd be like, okay, what time's your interview? And I'll be like, it's Monday at 8. And the voices kept telling me so often that I already missed it. It was on Saturday at 10 that I believed it and I missed my interview.
That's amazing. Have they ever told you to hurt yourself?
Yeah, they tell me to kill myself, like, at least once a day. And when I was, like, on the edge of maybe doing something like that, but I'm too much of a chicken shit. I can't take my own life. I've already been pushed to that point. It's not going to happen. But when I was very, very fragile at one point, they were literally, I was curled up in a ball on the floor, and they were screaming at me to kill myself, and they were trying to tell me ways to do it.
Wow, that's amazing. And this is what people have been saying, and people have been talking about that. They've been feeling suicidal, and, you know, it makes me really think, you know, the medical field, either they have no education that these sorts of technologies exist and they're being used, or they're in a complete denial and they don't want to have anything to do with it, or they're just a part of it. But people are actually hearing this, and it's legitimate. It's technology and people doing, like, experimentations or whatnot, or just attacks on people, and they're being told that there's something wrong with them and that they should take drugs.
Yeah, and the
right?
drugs don't help.
No, they don't. This is, how do people get protection from this?
I mean, there are people out there that do make tinfoil hats, like, legitimately. Like, I've seen helmets to little, like, you know, beanies of, like, tinfoil hats, thinking that the voice-to-skull technology won't get through these. I mean, myself, I've tried earplugs. I've tried, you know, putting blankets and pillows over my head. I've tried, you know, turning on the music really loud. Nothing helps. They can get through anything.
That's amazing. That's really amazing. You know, like, it sounds like you've been experimenting a little bit and trying to figure a way out to heal yourself. I mean, or just, you know, prevent this from happening. And it's fascinating. It's like, you know, I've gone through heavy gang stalking on a street level, and you've been going through gang stalking on a street level, and, you know, and that's one thing. I mean, that's bad enough, but, you know, the fact that people are, like, being stalked on the streets, and then there's technology involved, it sounds like something out of a Stephen King novel.
It does. It doesn't seem real. And they'll even go as far as making you self-doubt the smallest things. Like, they were just saying, hey, Rachel, did you realize when you took a shower a couple hours ago that you only shaved one of your legs? I'm like, I literally just checked, and they're lying to me. You know? They go from killing yourself to, oh, you only shaved one leg today. I mean, they're all
right
over the place.
Right. That is
But
amazing stuff.
I think the thing that they do, though, that's more disturbing than even telling you to kill yourself is they make you doubt everybody around you. Like, they're constantly telling you that people's motives aren't really what their motives are. And they're telling you that people secretly hate you because of this, that, or the other reason. And since they're observing you, you believe these reasons sometimes.
Right. This is some deep stuff. This is some really, really deep stuff, very sophisticated stuff. Like, and it's almost like we have to become scientists to understand it. Like, now we're looking into, technology. Somebody was telling me too, there's patents on this stuff, like the voice to skull technologies and stuff. Like, this isn't a joke. There's actual inventors and people who have patents on this sort of technology. And, we're gonna have to, in the future, we're gonna have to give a much more in-depth presentation. I'm gonna go back and hit the books. And we had a friend, a friend of mine came on here and was doing an interview with me and you, and he was very knowledgeable on the subject. We're gonna, put something back with him together on this, and we're gonna hit the books and go further into it. But you have like a wealth of experience. The fact that you're going through this and the fact that it's happening, it's like, that's enough right there to be able to make a good dialogue and a good presentation for people in the future to get a better handle on what we're talking about. And there's so many people that are waking up every day. Like, I, you know, there was a whole group of homosexual men who were hearing voices. That made the news. You remember that? Did you hear about that?
Yeah, it was like it was only targeted to them, though, right?
Yeah. It was like a colony of gay men that were living together, and they were all hearing voices in the area that they lived in. Like, literally everybody was. It wasn't just a couple people or five people. It was like 20 people that lived in the same region, and they were all hearing the same voices and stuff, and it actually made the news. And so, it's quite a story to think that this stuff can be happening and going on, and like, there's no real formal education coming out of the schools or the colleges about this, really. I mean, I'm sure people have done research reports on it, but there's no real community education on the subject. Just like gang stalking, there's no community education on gang stalking, organized stalking on the street. And, this is getting into the area of almost like, it almost reminds me of like, it's getting to like the paranormal almost.
Right. It seems paranormal to me because like the technology for it is so far advanced and so misunderstood, and there's not a lot of information on it that it almost seems like it could be coming from somewhere else.
And it's almost like, it's kind of scary in a way. It got me thinking, like, where's this stuff? Is it coming from like a different dimension or something? You know what I mean? Like, good thing that it's made the good thing it's made the news, and there's documentation on it. Because if we didn't have the documentation and we didn't have, the testimonies of the people who've been going through it, it would be a really spooky thing. Like, it would be like, what is happening? Are these,
Well,
there's
at
people online.
first, like my theories about it were very, very simple. I thought it was just as simple as like I pissed off someone and they talked a bunch of shit about me. So to play a prank on me, they would like before I would get anywhere, like say they knew I was coming back to like my baby's daddy's house. Well, they would just have a camera and a microphone in every room. Or if I go to check into a motel, they would just get there a little bit before me and put a little camera in there. Or people would just be stomping on my roof and like screaming down the vents, or screaming through the vents, or actually screaming on megaphones or through the walls. But when I realized it was way more complicated than that, that's when I started to actually get worried that there's something else going on than other than I just pissed someone off and they're getting back at me. Because at first I thought it was all just one big prank with relatively like known technology.
Yeah, that's when I first started getting gang stalked, I couldn't put it into proper perspective either. I kept thinking like, what's going on? How are all these different people a part of the same thing? And then I got to see that there's an actual stalking network that uses front organizations to recruit people to participate in the overall orchestration. Now is able to figure out how people are recruited, given Walmart cards, prepaid credit cards, told disinformation stories. Some of the people know what they're doing. They know they're stalking people, you know, but then a lot of other people don't know what they're doing. They're still participating in it. And it took me a long time to put into perspective what was actually happening. It took me a real long time. Like, you know, it took me, I mean, I've been going through it for 3 years, and to be at where I'm at and have the knowledge that I have on it, it's taken me a while through the experience of it, through seeing it, through feeling it, through studying it, through hearing it. And the voice of Skull, it, you know, this is an actual study. You know, it could take us, before we actually, you know, have a really good grasp on it, it may take us a few years, you know, and we're diligently working at it already.
Yeah, the voices just told me that I should come out there and do a live interview with you about this subject because they're trying to run me out of town.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, they come up with a reason for anything, and it literally drives you crazy because, like, sometimes there'll be times where I'm so paralyzed because I feel like my brain can't make a decision. Like, I can't decide whether I want to go to the grocery store or if I want to go to the temp agency for the day and maybe put in a couple hours down there. I'm just so paralyzed because they weigh out every decision I make and nitpick it apart over and over again to the point where sometimes, like, I just stay inside because I can't do anything because I'm just exhausted from being bombarded by choices that are not that difficult to make.
Right. Now, do you feel like this is ever going to end?
Well, see, that's just the thing. I'm actually relieved to have an answer to that because I'm pretty sure it's not going to. And once I realize that it's just something I'm going to have to deal with, the voices actually have quieted down a little bit. And I have no idea what the connection is there. It's just an observation. But, you know, it might be something I have to deal with for the rest of my life. So I'm just trying to find coping mechanisms with that and reaching out to you and talking to people about it and talking to other people who have gone through it has helped a lot.
Right. I'm so glad to hear that. And, like, we're not only doing, you know, the interviews with people, doing the counseling with people, and doing helping people with courses so they can learn new strategies to deal with gang stalking, but we're creating a forum for people to get out of the more populated areas into less populated areas. We're talking about taking targets of gang stalking, hiking and camping and stuff. I mean, well, once you're coming this way, we're going to meet soon. And so you think once you get out into nature and you think that might have a change to it?
Well, I've heard from other TIs, and then, you know, you being one of them, that getting out into nature and getting away from the hustle and bustle not only decreases the gang stalking, and for the people that don't hear the voices, I'm sure it's the same for you guys as to the people that do hear voices, that I'm pretty sure that the voice to skull will be toned down quite a bit. And it would just be nice to be out in nature because you don't have to make a decision out there. It's like, whether to start the campfire and make marshmallows or relax and look at stars, you know? I don't see how those two decisions can be so, like, messed up by a voice to skull that you'll be paralyzed and not be able to make it, you know?
Right. Absolutely. And so, you know, that's the goal. Right now we're working on the money bomb to find the people who, you know, want to participate. They want to get involved. They want to donate to providing some sort of realistic salvation to those in need. And because, again, there's no element in society pushing to assist these people. It's just kind of like the attitude just kind of like, fuck them. If you're being stalked in your neighborhood, fuck you. No one's going to help you, you know? And so we're taking that extra step in that leap, you know, one small step for us, but one big step for anybody who's ever going to go through this or their family or friends. And it's a big step for society in general or just the human species. But what would you have to say to people who are skeptical about the concept that we're working on and the steps we're taking to get off the grid and move people into a situation where there's less stalking and they can breathe for a moment? Like, what's our game plan for that? What's our goals for that? What are we working on?
So what my view of it is, you know, both me and Jamal have always had a knack for wanting to help people in life. Like we've always wanted to, you know, find our what's the word I'm looking for? Da-da-da-da, destiny. Destiny is kind of cheesy. A purpose. Find our purpose and have that purpose be in some way, shape, or form to help other people. And for those people who are like maybe suicidal or, you know, terrified or whatever, it'd be nice to have those emergency funds to maybe get them a Greyhound ticket out here to be around other TIs to kind of, you know, take that time to heal and take the time to educate about gang stalking and about the emotional effects it has and kind of recover a little bit from it and, you know, get a plan to move forward as well while they're here.
Right. So they can come out, sort of get a jump start on, you know, information, knowledge. You know, we're doing firsthand courses showing people through demonstration, you know, how they can take the power in their own hands, even talk to the people participating in gang stalking in a way to which they can feel safe and comfortable. And, you know, they can learn more about, you know, noise campaigns and, you know, the color stalking and the sensitization, and get more of a grasp on things. At the same time, break the sensitization that they've been through. You know, when they're living in populated areas, their friends and family and everybody know is stalking them. You know, using, you know, again, the color stalking, the brightening. You know, like we talk about in the distraction stage, how they add emotional connotation and psychological harassment onto the stalking that's already happening. This will be a time so people can break that level of sensitization, get more back into themselves, feel comfortable, and, you know, avoid the pitfalls, avoid psychotic shock, avoid making mistakes of possibly harming themselves or somebody else. And it's, you know, basically that's where the healing begins. And, you know, this will be a time too for the people, like you're saying, with the voice of skull, that they can get more of a better feeling of being in a natural environment. And it will take some of the dis it'll take some more of the pressure of it. It'll take the pressure off them. And, you know, like we're taking donations, and you know, we're working out of like motels and sleeping bags pretty much. It isn't a thing to where we're trying to create some sort of clinic where we need all these funds and everything. We're talking about if you can donate like $100 or $200 or perhaps, you know, $1,000 or even $1, you know, just the intention and the assistance, even a prayer will go a long way. You know, it's a spiritual, we know the spiritual dynamic to this and how these people, these demonic people are enemies of our God. But, you know, we're also need the monetary assistance to actually get out there and do it. And what would you like, how, do you have a vision for about how much money a month it would take to run the program that we put together?
Well, it all depends on how many people are involved, but I would say like one person, you know, on this like on this trip, maybe 300.
That would be a start. You said $300 and for how far would that go? How long would that take us?
Probably
Like,
like a 3-day stay or something.
right, like a 3-day thing, right? I feel you. I like that. That's about what I was seeing. And you know, the people are going to get evidence and documentation. We're going to provide like video footage of it. We're going to be doing interviews the whole time, you know, video footage, personal accounts. Like, this is going to be like a thing to where, you know, once it happens, it's going to be a big victory anyway, because us people being gang stalked coming together, wouldn't you say that that's a hell of a victory? Just for it to happen for one day is a hell of a psychological, spiritual victory, wouldn't you say so?
I would think so. Yes, that is a victory because if the perps haven't stopped us from getting over there and connecting, that's a victory. Even me just sitting here talking to you guys and talking to Jamil on YouTube is a victory.
Right. We're making victories all the time. we're making those steps all the time. Like we're steady, you know, we're always looking for a new blow to strike, so to speak. And you know, we've done it, you know, and we stuck, after we did it, we stuck around for the glory of it, and we're doing it again. And we've had people come in the last few days that we've been talking to, but we're really looking for those people that are very serious about it. Like, what would you say about the people who have doubts and fear? Like, it, you know, how can they overcome those doubts and fears? And, you know, what are we, what kind of qualities are we looking for in the people?
So I've been trying to think on that. I guess I can only really share my own personal experience, but I'm relatively new to getting stalking. I just found out about it about 2 weeks ago. And it does take a big leap of faith on my part, because we all do have trust issues. We've all been through trauma. And really, like, I'm going just by my intuition, because like Carmen was saying in an earlier interview we did, our intuition is the only thing we can really trust. We can't even really trust what we feel sometimes, because they have machines out there that can program us to feel different than what we should be feeling at a point in time. And so I'm thinking, well, I did look through tons and tons of YouTube videos, and I'm not saying anything bad about those videos by any means. I'm just saying that there's a lot of really good information out there. There's a lot of good videos with good intentions out there. There's a lot of good videos with just like a wealth of knowledge and, you know, people connecting and people learning about this, and other, you know, people getting the word out about this. You know, knowledge is power. And I haven't seen too much about where to go from here. And that's why I reached out to Jamil, because he's looking forward. Like, after we heal from, like, the trauma and everything, it's like, well, what now? And that's what we're working on right now, is the what now. And I'm actually going to be the first person to go out and feel out this kind of, you know, fill out this kind of, like, I don't want to call it a program because it's not program yet, but, you know, kind of get on the ground floor of this. So I'm actually going to be the first guinea pig to go out there and try this out and see what it's all about, see if it works, if it's not working, see what we can do to perfect it. And so I'm pretty much going to be the guinea pig, because my intuition tells me that it's safe and that it'll be well worth the trip.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm so glad that you stepped forth to do that, because you remind me of what I was going through in the spring of 2016 when I went from here to Arizona. And that's where I developed my first course. Is like, I started learning to approach the gang stalkers, talk to them. I started learning different sorts of stuff. And, you know, going that far away from where I was already at getting gang stalk was really strange. I was by myself when I did it. And, you know, but it helped me a lot. It gave me a lot of insight. And you coming out here, you know, you're going to be getting gang stalked all the way out here. And then once you get here, now we're going to be together, two people getting gang stalked, and we can put this stuff together and formulate it. And, you know, your inspiration, your courage is a testimony to people, because sometimes people are so pessimistic and negative, it's like they almost want stuff to fail on purpose, you know. And the fact that you don't have that mindset, that you have a courageous mindset and a victorious mindset, really says a lot about the spirit of this program that we're putting together. It's a testimony to the spiritual essence of what we're doing, you know, and that's what we want. We want people who have that courageous spirit, the people who are tired of you know, being victims, the people who are tired of that sick victim mentality. You know, we're not looking for like a bunch of self-congratulatory people, you know, who have really little reason to boast or whatever. We want people to work for these victories and put that effort in. And, you know, that's what's happening here is, you know, you've been working hard. You just discovered a week and a half ago what gang stalking was, and you've come an amazingly long way since the beginning of this. And at this point right now, it's like, you've already learned about the confusion stage, distraction stage, sensitization stage. I came up with those three stages recently, like a few months ago. I came up with those three stages, and the four elements are how manipulated sound, natural sound, and synthetic sound, how they're messing with people through the noise campaigns, sight, objects, people, colors, and light, covert drugging, electronic weapons. That's the four elements that I have presented. There's more to it, you know, in the strategic planning, how the gang stalked us through entry-exit strategies. You know, the hand signals seem to be a big part of the coordination of the gang stalking, not just technology, community watch apps, and whatnot, but there's actual, you know, nonverbal gestures that people are using to communicate the stalking. There's a lot of different stuff we have to put in perspective to educate ourselves and educate other people. And that's something we're going to be doing together more in person. But now you've included something very powerful, the voice to skull, you know, the voice to skull. And you're going to be bringing that here with you. It's not, I have not been able to experience that yet, but I'm thankful that you'll be able to bring that here with you. And it'll be a complete package, you know, for the people who have not heard me talk about voice to skull a lot. Now you're here and we're putting interviews together and we're going to be in person. So now I have to include it. I got no choice but to include it, you know, and we're going to be teaching people how to beat that, how to beat the voice to skull. So.
And the voices are saying right now that even though you don't hear the voice to skull, they're saying if I do go out there, that you're going to hear a lot of people, more people shouting stuff at you because they're like, oh, well, make him hear it. You know, they're like teasing me right now. But I wouldn't be surprised if you get more noise campaigns as a result of this. It's going to be pretty interesting to see.
Right, right. Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, and we're working on other things. We're working on organic food, you know. That within itself is a big testament to the seriousness that we're taking about our health and about the health of other people. A lot of people are concerned about traveling this far. They know their food could be drugged. And when people get drugged, you know, I know when I got covertly drugged, I got sick. I was passing out. I didn't know I was going to die or not. I had to teach myself to go to buffets because they don't drug buffet. They can't, you know, it's food that everybody's sharing. So, but can't everybody go to a buffet all the time? People have to find ways to eat healthy food, stuff they can trust. And that's something we're working on. We're creating, you know, a set of values based on beating gang stalking, and we're integrating it into every aspect of life, eating, shopping, certain stores we go to. I know me and you both agree that Walmart may not be in our best, Walmart not be the best place for us to shop just because there's more gang stalking at Walmart. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely. And something else that I think is a really, really important goal that I want to get out there to people is that upon their return or whenever they decide to depart, hopefully we'll have an individualized plan for them for what they can do from here on forward. Because my thing that I'm going out there for is to see if maybe, because I've heard like gang stalking's worse in the big cities, and I've heard of people moving from the Seattle area, which I'm from. Oh, like a lot of people have moved from the away from here because it's so bad, and it's not as bad in other places like the Midwest. And so we're actually gonna see about maybe a relocation of my family. So this is kind of like a test drive out there too, and we'll see what my individual life plan looks like at the end of this.
Absolutely, absolutely. So this is a big change in your whole life right now, you know. You're really just going with it, and you're not about to let nothing hold you back. And, you know, we are very excited to see what can come out of this. You know, it's like me and you have built a friendship in the last few days, and you've learned a lot, and I've learned a lot, and we've made a lot of progress. Like, we just accomplished, like, 10 interviews, like, literally 10 interviews of education on gang stalking radio with a lot of hours into it, and we went through that like it wasn't nothing. And so I can be surprised of what we're going to put together in the future, you know. And then we did the mind control and gang stalking interview part one and part two. We did the less gang stalking in less populated areas interview. You know, it's like we're just knocking it down right now no matter what. And so one of the things that's going to be happening here pretty soon is you're going to have a success story conclusion to this, like 8 weeks, 6 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks. You're going to know, like, you might end up just like living out here in Michigan, You know what I mean? And or we might be end up traveling, like, you know, everybody just might end up traveling together somewhere. Who knows what's gonna happen? We might end up going someplace other, you know, who knows what's gonna come out? It's gonna be something historical either way. Now, what do you think about
Yeah,
my
but I don't
lab?
want to give people the wrong impression though. It's not like we're gonna like suggest everybody pack up
Right.
and move. For those people that
Right.
aren't gonna be relocating, we can at least send them back with the tools that they need to do this
Yeah.
where, you know, wherever they're
Oh.
from.
Yeah. Whatever, wherever they're from or wherever they feel is most comfortable for them, you know, they'll go back home. They'll go back home with a whole new set of values, a whole new set of skills, and they'll be able to take care of themselves and do what they need where they're going back to, and possibly go out and find other people in their area going through gang stalking and teach them what they've learned. You know, I mean, you know,
Absolutely.
that's, yeah. Now, what do you think about, you know, have you heard of MyLab, the military abduction, Black Project stuff, and MK Ultra and all that?
I have read into the MK Ultra. I don't think I've come across the first thing you said though.
MyLab, like the black helicopters, like MyLab is like people claiming that they're actually being abducted by black projects, like black operators and stuff, like secret technology that's, you know, like some deep stuff, you know, weird
I've
stuff.
seen the black helicopters, but nothing's come of it.
Okay. And then with the MK Ultra and all this stuff, you know, I kind of want to take this time right now to introduce this stuff, because even with the group stalking, you have Scientology stalking. And Scientology stalking is similar to gang stalking, but it's a little bit different. And then people can identify Scientology as being the group that's doing it to them. And I always tell people, if you don't know what gang stalking is, just look at Scientology stalking. It's the same thing, as just no one supposedly knows. There's no supposed reason for it to be happening, but it's still happening. So it's gang stalking. But now MK Ultra, my lab, military abduction, stuff like that. I mean, what do you think we would have to offer somebody going through MK Ultra? Like, if somebody just popped up, like, hey, I was taken into a laboratory, my mind was messed with so many years ago or recently, and I'm not being gang stalked, but I need help. My perception of reality has been altered through something. There's been a mutation in my consciousness through experimentation. Do you think that we might be able to help people, you know, along that line as well? Or do you think this is solely just for the people going through gang stalking? Like, what is there a discriminatory, is there a discrimination line?
I wouldn't think so because the MK Ultra stuff has some of the components that gang stalkers use, and they're very, very important components. Like it does deal with mind control and drugging, behavior modification,
Right.
you know, and you know, it, I know a lot of people from the MK Ultra, like pretty much like they're you know, they know what's going on, they're well read on the subject and everything, they know all about it. But we can also help recover them from it because I don't think, like in the big scope of things, the solution will be much different from someone who went through MK Ultra to someone who's been drugged and had the voice to skull experience. Because I know
Right,
I was
absolutely.
sent to a place where I thought I was being reprogrammed too. So I think they overlap.
It does overlap, and you know, I'm so glad that you're such a quick learner and you just put things in a proper perspective, because that's exactly what's happening. The radiation experiments of MK Ultra are the same thing that's happening to people who are getting gang stalked. You know, and radiation is just the emission of energy as electromagnetic waves or as moving subatomic particles, especially high energy particles that cause ionization, divergence out from a central, in the second definition in biology, divergence out from a central point of articular evolution of an ancestral animal or plant group into a variety of new forms. Okay, the second definition didn't really have anything to do with it, but as you can see, the use of electromagnetic weapons, ionization and whatnot, you know, that's something they're using to mess with people's minds. They're looking to damage people's minds and scar people, you know, through radiological means, in gang stalking, you know, chemical covert drugging. And you know, it's evident that somebody going through the classical MK Ultra experience, whether they're in a laboratory, they would have the same positive effects within education on gang stalking, because we get the same sorts of things happen to us. It just doesn't happen to us in a laboratory. They've turned our whole neighborhood into a laboratory, right? You see what I'm saying?
Right?
Yeah, they've turned the
The
whole neighborhood
voices.
into a laboratory. They've turned the whole
Yeah, I
country
do.
into a
I feel like
laboratory.
we're like a rat in a maze sometimes. And the voices right now are saying to me, what they're saying right now is, we did not dose you with LSD. We hypnotized you while you were sleep deprived. I just thought I'd chime in what they have to say about it, but that's not correct.
Like, you know, and a lot of people have termed it unethical human experimentation. And what have you, I just want to do a reading real quick. Human radiation experiments. Researchers in the United States have performed thousands of human radiation experiments to determine the effects of atomic radiation and radioactive contamination on the human body, generally on people who are poor, sick, or powerless. Most of these tests were performed, funded, or supervised by the United States Military, Atomic Energy Commission, or various other U.S. federal government agencies. The experiments include a wide array of studies involving things like feeling radioactive food, things like feeding radioactive food to mentally disabled children or conscientious objectors, inserting radium rods into the noses of school children, deliberately releasing radioactive chemicals over U.S. and Canadian cities, measuring the health effects of radioactive fallout from nuclear bomb tests, injecting pregnant women and babies with radioactive chemicals, and iridating, I can't, I'm sorry, I can't pronounce it, the testicles of prison inmates, amongst other things. Much information about these programs were classified and kept secret. In 1986, the United States House Committee on Energy and Commerce released a report entitled American Nuclear Guinea Pig, 3 decades of radiation experiments on U.S. citizens in the 1990s. Ellen Wellsum's report on radiation testing for the Albuquerque Tribune promoted the creation of Advisory Committee on Human Radiation Experiments by executive order of President Bill Clinton to monitor government tests. It published results in 1995. Wilson later wrote a book called The Plutonium Files. See, it's going down. See what I'm saying? That's something that people are going to be learning at education on gang stalking. And so, you know, it's showing that these experimentations are being done on just regular people off the streets, pregnant mothers, babies, all sorts of people, you know. And you're talking about the voice to skull. People sit there and go, "Why? Why is it happening? Why? Why would they?" Well, you just learned, you know, it's happening. They're just doing it, you know. So I don't know. You know, this takes me back to the money bomb and getting people off the grid and back into nature. You know, have you ever heard any of that stuff before on the radiation experiments, Rachel?
Not the radiation one specifically, but they do just like target people. Like from the beginning of time, it seems like they target people and just run these experiments on us. I'm not really pinpointing any right now. But yeah, they do use mind control and all this stuff on just us day-to-day life, and it's going on all the time. It's just not enough people are getting together and talking about it out of fear for sounding crazy or being discredited.
Most definitely, most definitely. And you know, we can't help but to go back to MK Ultra. And you know, it states here, in 1953, the CIA placed several of its interrogation and mind control programs under the direction of a single program known by the code name MK Ultra. After CIA Director Alan Dulles complained about not having enough human guinea pigs to try these extraordinary techniques, the MK Ultra project was under the direct command of Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, of Technical Services Division. I just want to stop right there. Dr. Gottlieb was a Nazi. I just want to, and so I'm going to go on. The project received over 25 million and involved hundreds of experiments on human subjects at 80 different institutions. In a memo describing the purpose of one MK Ultra program subprogram, Richard Helms said, "We intend to investigate the development of a chemical material which causes reversible, non-toxic I can't pronounce that, mental state, the specific nature of which can be reasonably well predicted for each individual. This material could potentially aid in discrediting individuals, eliciting information, and implanting suggestions and other forms of mental control. See, implanting suggestions, that's what you're talking about, the voice of skull. And that's Richard Helms' internal CIA memo. In 1954, the CIA's project QK Hilltop was created to study Chinese brainwashing techniques and to develop effective methods of interrogation. Most of the early studies are believed to have been performed by the Cornell University Medical School's Human Ecology Study Program under the direction of Dr. Harold Wolf. Wolf requested that the CIA provide him any information they could find regarding threats, coercion, imprisonment, deprivation, humiliation, torture, brainwashing, black psychiatry, and hypnosis, or any combination of these without chemical agents. According to Wolf, the research team would then assemble, collate, analyze, and assimilate this information and will then undertake an experimental investigation designed to develop new techniques of offensive/defensive intelligence use, potentially useful secret drugs, and various brain damaging, and various brain damaging procedures will be similarly tested in order to ascertain the fundamental effect upon human brain function and upon the subject's mood. Where any of these studies involve potential harm to the subject, we expect the agency to make available suitable subjects and proper place for the performance of the necessary experiments. And that's Dr. Harold Wolf, Cornell University Medical School. This stuff is pretty interesting stuff. I mean, basically they've turned people into guinea pigs in the past. And when you speak about the voice of skull, I don't see how that could be far-fetched in the present. I mean, if people have been doing this stuff for decades, you know, and that's an official, those are official agencies. Think about how many unofficial people are doing this. You know, you can imagine if somebody was given this sort of technology and they just ran rampant with it and there was no checks and balances.
Yeah, like I'm sure it's not hard to figure out how to subliminally message people, you know, and I'm sure people are, you know, abusing that like all the time.
Yeah. So this is where education comes in on, you know, this is where education comes in at. And so, you know, we just got to remain diligent on that and be responsible and keep coming up with new ways to help people. Just stay active and, you know, proactive and, you know, keep giving people the counseling and the courses. And now we're doing the off the grid thing. And I think everything's coming into focus. I mean, how do you feel about it, Rachel?
Yeah, it seems like, you know, at first we were just kind of throwing darts out there and seeing where they're landing. Now we actually have a direction that we're going to go.
Yeah, most definitely. Now we have a direction we're going to go. So, you know, we did the 10-part series, the education on gang stalking radio, episode 1 through 10. And we laid down some other videos, and now this is a new video that we're putting out for people just to get some insight into who you are, more about the voice of the skull you've experienced, and to know a little bit about our program that we're putting together to get people off the grid. And, you know, we've just been instrumental in bringing people together. We've gotten a lot of people on phone calls with each other, and people have been able to exchange emails, phone numbers. And this is a positive system where you know, we're learning to sponsor people. Like, I've been sponsoring you, and now you're getting ready to be in a position to where you're going to be sponsoring people. And this is something really cool and that we can do ourselves. We don't need any outside influence. You know, we don't need to be crybabies and sit around and complain. Now we can take action ourselves. And all we have is telephones and YouTube channels. And, you know, we're working out of motels and sleeping bags. And we're still doing it, you know, we're still kicking those doors in, you know, getting our point across and making sure it goes down no matter what. And so, you know, if somebody could just come through and donate $100, $500, $1,000, $5,000, I mean, every penny will be used to save people's lives. I mean, you're talking about suicidal people, people prone to violence, people on drugs. I mean, this is saving people's lives. I mean, I know it's helped you put into vision what's happening to you and where you're going. Now you're talking about moving out here, and this is a thing to where it's changed your whole life. And, you know, how many lives do you feel we can save?
As many as are willing to come forward and give it a try. And as we do this more and more, we'll have more information and, you know, more tailored experience to each person.
Right.
I want to throw out there, if anybody has any information on technology and how it's used to surveillance us, but how it's marketed to us for other things, like say GPS or Siri or anything like that, tracking systems, anything, any information on that is welcome. Same with Voice to Skull. Same with, there was one more thing we needed a little bit more information on. I'm spacing it now. But yeah, anything like technology based that can be used in the gang stalking, we would love more information on. So I'm throwing that out there just as a kind of left field comment here.
And we wouldn't be opposed to people who are participating in this stuff stepping forward and shedding some light on it. If somebody has participated in gang stalking at a street level, you know, we'd be more than welcome to keep them confidential if they wanted to send some helpful information on how their perception of their activity was, or if they have some insight, if they participated in the creation of these sorts of directed energy weapons and whatnot, or they have worked on some sort of program involving Voice of Skull. Like, we would not be opposed to those sorts of people formally contacting us and shedding insight, and their knowledge would go to save lives. I mean, wouldn't you feel that was
any
important
former
part?
People that like participated in gang stalking but didn't know it at the time.
Right, and you know they no longer want to be an enemy of their god, and you know. Basically, that's what it is. You know, they turn themselves into enemies of, you know, of our God. But yeah, that's absolutely right. That's absolutely right. They want to get involved and shed some light and save some lives. Wouldn't that be awesome? Wouldn't that be really cool if somebody just wanted to give it up, give some information up, and help us to help save people?
Absolutely.
Right.
And one more thing about the voices, this is kind of like my sign-off for the voices. So this is another example for those people experiencing voice to skull and those people that also do not experience it. Right now I'm sitting out on my porch. I just moved rooms. And they love to do this because it's kind of noisy out here. There's cars going by. I can hear a train, even though there's no trains nearby. That's weird. But anyway, they also like to impersonate neighbors talking bad about you. So every time, like, I step outside, you know, they're just doing their own thing. The neighbors aren't saying anything. But, like, they put in my head that they're saying, like, all these awful things about me and that they're commenting on my every action.
Isn't that something? That's horrible, you know? That's
like right
cool.
Now they're impersonating one of my neighbors saying, oh, she's just sitting over there like talking all conspiracy theories, but really she's just a schizophrenic.
Isn't that something? How
when they're just all minding their business, you know?
Right, the degeneracy of it all. The degeneracy of it all. Well, you know what? We got some really good stuff down tonight, Rachel. And you know, we're definitely gonna be back speaking tomorrow with each other, you know, and come up with some new ways that we can do all this stuff and implement, you know, our you know, our God's work more for people. And you know, I mean, the floor is open to you. If there's anything you just want to talk about, you know, it's you know.
Are you asking me a question?
Well, I was just saying we put some really good groundbreaking work together, you know, in this last hour. You know, we've been out here about an hour and 5 minutes, and it was a wonderful hour that we put together, and there will be more wonderful hours to come that we will spend with each other, teaching people more about gang stalking and more about this technology they're using, and you know, teaching people more about, you know, the things that we've been through. And, You know, if I was saying, if you feel you would like to add some more information to, so for the listeners, the floor is open to you, wherever you want to go, or if you want to wrap it up, we can do that. It's up to you. I'm in no rush. It's completely up to you, Rachel.
I think we covered everything that I think we covered everything that was the purpose of this video. I'm just still stressing because I'm really I this is me for my personal curiosity. This is just for me, guys, because I really wanted to talk to the gentleman who was able to compartmentalize the voice to skull, like what's coming from the inside, what's coming from the outside, and the difference between that and neuro, what was that, neuro programming? What kind of programming was that?
Neuro-linguistic programming.
Yeah, any information on the difference between those two, because I think both are being done to me, and I think both are being done to quite a few other people out there. So any information on that, just to satisfy my own personal curiosity, would be great, and just so we have more information altogether for everyone else.
Right. No doubt. No doubt. More information. Yeah, that's Josh, and I'll talk to Josh tomorrow. And we'll get him back on with us because he put some really good stuff into perspective, and he has some great insight. And I really want to hear where you two can take this because Josh has extreme insight into remote neural monitoring, neuro-linguistic programming, and the voice to skull thing. And he is an MK Ultra survivor himself, so he not only has knowledge, he has experience. And I think, once we get us three back on here together, he'll be able to take some time out and break that back down for us. And so the listeners will definitely get some education on the effects of these heinous implementations they've been doing to us. That's for damn sure. And time is of an essence. We have to have everything. We have to have everything there for everybody as soon as we can. It's not simple for us to coordinate all this stuff. We do the best we can, and we try to put things in the proper perspective as we can. And we're hoping our listeners can be generous and donate now to the GoFundMe and the PayPal on the YouTube channel. And we'll be back with some more education and some more knowledge and some more light, some more light on the subject, with
And a
that,
big thank you to those who have already donated as well. There have been some very generous people.
we can never forget the people who've already have donated, and there has been generous people, and that's testimony to the good work we're doing. People aren't donating just to be donating because they're bored. People are donating because they know the work that we're doing is real, and so that's just more testimony to what we've done. And so we thank those people, and we thank the listeners. And the people to come, we think the people to come, they haven't even come yet, but they will be here, and so
Yes, and all
I'm
the people who have taken the time for us to do interviews and taking the time to weigh in and even just comment or like the video.
right. Absolutely. 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 And we pray for those people. We pray for those people, and they're in our prayers and in our hearts, and we're hoping that, that whatever's happening to them, that they can get through it, and they know that they can always reach out to us no matter what. And we will contact, if they email us, we will talk to them, in a confidential setting, one-on-one, or three-on-one, two-on-one, one of me, you, whatever it takes. And we will get them to where they need to be, or at least get them to know that they are not alone, and that, wherever their life takes them, they will have some company and some insight to go with that, and
I think this might be a good place to leave off because the voices just said, "Now, Rachel, this is where you say good afternoon, good evening, and good night."
isn't that something? Okay, well,
It's from The Truman Show. It's my favorite movie.
oh, really? Okay. Right. All right, well, yeah, this is a good place to leave off. And then hold on, I want to talk to you for a couple seconds before it's over, and we'll just hang up on this call, and I'm gonna call you right back for just a couple seconds, all right?
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, all right. Yeah.